So today's guest is a brilliant actor, best known for his appearances in Walt Before Mickey, The Men Who Stare at Goats with George Clooney, the CMT series Nashville, which I'm a huge fan of, and he's frontman for Diamond Rocks, the legendary concert tribute to Neil Diamond. And admittedly, we reconnected recently after I spotted him in an episode of Drop Dead Diva, which I incidentally happened to be binge-watching at the time. All right, let's get into it. Hey, I'm Solomon Jay, and welcome to Beyond Mediocre, where I get to sit and talk with creative professionals about what they are doing to push beyond mediocre. Now, before we get into it, if you can please hit subscribe to show support for shows like this and click the notification bell to stay in the loop and updated on new episodes. Now, today we have another very special guest, Mr. Donn Lamkin. Don, thank you very much for being here.
Oh, thank you. It's an honor to be here with you, Solomon.
Yeah, I'm glad you can make it, and I'm digging the hat, actually.
Thanks, man.
So, just a little bit about yourself.
A little bit about me. I grew up performing. I've never had another job outside of performing.
Wow.
And it started with the high school I went, which is a theater school in St. Louis. Mm. From there I did theme parks like Six Flags and a couple other dinner shows, riverfront dinner shows. Then I went to Nashville. I was hired doing Opryland.
Oh, sweet.
Which was all live music and all live orchestra. It's the best. But we also had corded mics at that time.
So okay.
I'm really aging myself. First of all, Opryland's not there anymore. So not only were we singing and dancing, there was a show called Way Out West, but the microphones recorded. So any movement that you did, and there was a lot of dancing in there too, everything was choreographed around not getting the mics tangled, but it was a great place. A lot of performers at Opryland at that time, went onto Broadway, which I have a huge interest in as well. Right after Opryland, I went to Disney World.
Okay.
And I've been at Disney for 30 years. And now, after 30 years, I'm no longer there because of the COVID thing. So I got let go, right?
Yeah.
But I performed, I opened the studios in 1989.
Wow.
Disney, man. MGM Studios at the time, and they changed the name to Hollywood Studios. And I did some singing there, but mostly I was an MC, I hosted celebrities that came, they put their handprints in cement, that old tradition.
Yeah.
And so I've interviewed over 2,000 celebrities there.
Oh, jeez.
I've hosted many shows, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, Let's Make a Deal, Superstar Television. Ended up at Indiana Jones, and then I did Lights, Motors, Action, which was an extreme stunt car driving show. But I've always been, the host.
That's awesome.
But most notably, what people will know is the voice of Disney. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to Disney's Animal Kingdom. In just a few moments, please take your seats as we due to inclement weather. So I did a lot of voiceovers for those 30
That's
years
awesome.
For Disney. Some are still being in use as well. But Disney, because of the times, it was hard, especially at this age. So my whole life, and in addition to what I told you, what I grew up with. So 30 years and all of a sudden, nothing. What do you do? Well, you freak out a little bit, you get depressed a little bit. Like, well, what else can I do? Luckily, during that time that I was at Disney, and this isn't the first time this has happened that I was worried about Disney, okay? It happened during 9/11. Do you remember this?
Oh.
So,
yeah.
Disney had closed the park, and in order to get back and get the economy back and everything else with Disney, they let go of all their musicians. So the first to be let go is the musicians.
Jeez, I didn't know about that.
And here, I'm hosting a show over there, and I was like, well, gosh, what if I lost my job? Well, what could I be doing? And somebody said, well, Don, you should sing Neil Diamond. You like Neil Diamond. You sound like him. So do a, why don't you do a Diamond tribute show? And I said, no. I'm not a fan of the tributes. They try too hard to be somebody else that they're not. They're just creepy people. But I started doing some research, and I said, nobody's doing that big band, the big concert band with Neil Diamond. And I said, what's going to make the difference for me to do it is I'm going to talk about Neil in the show. I'm going to tell his stories. I'm going to tell my personal stories because I'm such a fan. And that will make a difference from an impersonator to doing actual tribute. Now, I have the resemblance of Neil at the time and the voice, you know. So, and I got these musicians from Disney. They were all out of work. And I said, let's do this. But I'm going to make it big. Okay? I want the big band. I want the concert
band. That's how you do it.
Nobody's doing it. And I had everything scored, which was key. Written out. Horn section, you know, three horns, everything written down. The reason being is because since it's such a big band, it's hard to take, you know, 13 people to another state and set up.
Yeah.
So you take your core band. Mm-hmm. You bring the music. You hire the local musicians. We go through a rehearsal. We do the ins and outs. All they have to do is read the music and we have a show.
That's absolutely the way to do it. I'm a huge proponent of that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And it adds an extra layer of professionalism to it, too. It makes people look at you like, oh, he's a real musician.
Yeah, which, yeah. Absolutely. It's that comfort there. Because, you know, most don't. They're using karaoke tracks or whatever.
Yeah.
And I'm not a fan of that.
I'm not.
Now, we do use sweetener tracks, you know.
Yeah.
But even right after that, when we started doing the show is called Diamond Rocks. We booked a gig in Alaska, a cruise, 7 days, 3 times, so 3 weeks on the cruise. I was able to bring my core band in. And when the curtain opened, we hooked up with the musicians on the ship and their backup vocals on the ship. When that curtain opened, we had a 13-piece band, and they've never had that size band on that ship before. So like I said, 9/11 happened. And then I just took those musicians and held on to them. And they were dedicated because I tried to pay as what I could at the time. Mm. But here's the other key, too. Always pay your musicians.
Yeah.
And I pay them. I pay them first day. I pay them for rehearsals and everything because you use that kind of money. And they will stay with you. So that's the story on that.
And well, let me first say, with regards to the approach to the tribute, I'm a big fan of that approach, and I've always felt the same way. I'm the kind that can adjust my voice to fit different kind of scenarios, speaking voice and, you know, in terms of singing and whatnot. And while I can come close to impersonating some people, it never feels to me like it's all the way there. Mm-hmm. I play it back, and I'm not thoroughly convinced. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things I never, ever, ever do is try to present myself or pass myself off as this person. This is my tribute to James Brown.
Exactly.
I'm not James Brown. Exactly. My tribute to Sammy Davis Jr. I cannot be Sammy.
All of
those things. And I feel like people appreciate it more because then your personality and your quirks come through and they actually like it. It doesn't take away so much as add to the performance.
Right.
And that's fantastic.
It's an emotional connection. First of all, your audience already knows the music, you know, so they're already connected to it. And then you bring your passions with it, and they're right there with you because they feel the same way about this music or however you're performing it.
Yeah.
So it's just my quality of my voice just doesn't sound like Neil Diamond. So there's nothing much that I can change, you know. Except, you know, do Sammy, man. You know.
I can't even do that.
You know, my... I'm bent over like this, not because my back is bad, it's because these rings are so darn heavy. But
and I cannot pull it off. I can't pull
well,
it off.
Well, don't. Wow, now what do I do? Well, thankfully, as we will discuss, I'll bring it up right now, I've been really writing a musical. Initially, it's for Broadway, but I'm really feeling now it's going to be a movie musical. I think it's going to be easier. Mm. But it is based on Neil Diamond's songbook of over 50 years. And I've taken the lyrics of his songs and created a show called Nola. It takes place in New Orleans, you know, in the 60s.
Beautiful concept.
Yes. And so I created these characters and created a whole story for this musical. And so knock on wood, that's still there, but still. Broadway's not going to open for another year now, you know.
Right, right.
At least we can still record, and then we have a, He's excellent on it, by the way. He's one of the lead characters in NOLA, and we've toured a lot with Michael Andrew, who a lot of people should know, especially here in Orlando. He did a show himself with Jerry Lewis, you know? He did The Nutty Professor.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. But Jerry had passed before he got to Broadway. So he's very much involved. He did all the arrangements, you know, and he does all of our recordings right now to get the concept album out. Really, really fun show, as you know. I'm not going to give too many more details on it.
Yeah.
You know, I want to keep it under the hat. But so now what? I started writing a book 30 years at Disney. Strictly the Hollywood studios, all the shows that I've done, all the celebrities that I've been with, and other shows that I perhaps weren't in. But it was that golden age of Hollywood. Hmm. So I have Imagineers in the book, the directors, actors, technicians, the stunt drivers, you know, everything involved in this golden age of Hollywood. And it's really a terrific ride in itself, you know. And some of the, especially the celebrity interviews that I had and the stories that I recall. So that's in the works. But again, you know, a book takes a long time, though, too, you know.
Yeah.
Plus getting the publisher, which I do have. So so that's what else I've been doing, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. You got to keep those juices flowing. And that's the key. I know we discussed a little bit before we sat down and rolled the camera, that you have to have that energy to do it. You have to take the risks.
Yeah.
Now is the time to do it. You think, there's nothing going on. There's nothing out there. No, you have to create what's going on. Do it for you. Don't wait on somebody else to tell you.
Yeah.
Or now we have an open, or go audition, or go, you know. Because what's frustrating, and I understand a lot of your viewers probably feel this way too, because you work so hard and there's so much rejection in this industry.
Yeah.
And you work so hard and you put your own money into something, and then it's like, where's it going? It's not going, you know, what happened? But you can't stop. You go, all right, let me push the river a little bit harder. You know?
Yeah, man.
Let me take the risk a little bit harder. You know, this was just a couple of rocks. You know, we had to dodge. But the water's still going to flow. Those creative juices are still going to flow. Just think of what can I do? Even if it's absurd, believe in it, follow that focus, and just keep at it, because you never know. Find something nobody else has done before, and even though you think it's crazy and people are like, are you nuts? No. If you're passionate about it, keep to it.
Uh-huh.
It will happen eventually, as long as you stick to it.
Yeah.
I am a real person. We are real people. We are creative people. We can't not be creative.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? We have to be creative. It's the lifeblood. It's the life flowing through us. So how do we do it? How do we make it work? And I'm going to give you a couple. You talk to others who want to be in it. You want to work with other people. The more you work with other people and collaborative, it will go. Don't think you can do it on your own. Nobody's successful by themselves. Yeah. Everybody else has helped that person along the way.
Yeah.
Or even vice versa. So just get in there. Find that group of friends. Here's an idea. Let's start this way. And that's your source. Friends. Especially now. Everybody's looking for work. Why don't you tap into that? It's a community. Stick with the community. Keep watching your cast and others out there as well.
Mm-hmm. That's very real. I mean, there has to be, like another friend of mine put it, you gotta find small victories.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to figure out how to determine what small victories there are for yourself. And especially in this kind of scenario where the alternative is nothing at all, you have everything to gain from doing something.
Yeah.
You know?
It helps to put a timeline on it too. You gotta be pressured by a deadline. Okay? Even within yourself.
Yeah.
Say, here's the deadline to get to this point. Always have that dry erase calendar.
Yeah.
You know, and put on and say, I gotta achieve it here. And those little victories, and next thing you know, in a month or two, you're like, oh my God, look how far we come. I couldn't have done that without setting my own deadline. It has to be done.
Yeah.
I want to ask you, in writing songs, when do you get your inspiration? Is it at night? Do you just wake up or are you going to bed? I'm like, oh my God, that's it. And I have to write something down.
Yeah. My, more often than not, that little place between sleep and awake, mm-hmm. when when it's most agitating to have to get up and try to notate something,
right.
That's when it happens. I'll be like, oh, just about to pass out, and there go all the ideas. And I'm like, ah, I got to do it. And I'll get up and record into the voice memo and then come to it the next day or
first thing
in the morning and jot something down.
I have a notepad next to my bed. And especially writing the book, I was like, oh my gosh, that would be great. Oh, that's great. Yeah, I remember that story. And then if you don't do it, I wake up and I'm like, oh my gosh, what was I thinking? I'm trying to remember what I was thinking last night, you know? So now I force myself, I don't care how tired, you know, turn on the light and write it down. Mm. And it's there. You know, everybody had struggles. You know, there's a program that I was talking, it's on Access, and it's called the Big Interview, Dan Rather.
Mm.
And it's all musicians. It's really fascinating. Dan Rather, what does he know about music?
Yeah.
You know? However, he's fascinating in interviews. And they really just disclose all the troubles and what they did to pull through on a lot of that programming, you know. So we're not alone, but you need that worry. And you need that fear.
Yeah.
That's what pushes you. As you know, as a stage performer as well, you walk out on that stage, if you're not prepared, but that's that feel. Okay, here I go. I'm going to jump out of the airplane and step on that stage and see what's going to happen. Yeah. Anything can go wrong. That's all. Okay, I'm going to lose the lyric. I'm going to, you know, my microphone's not going to be plugged in. You know, I had a show. I walked out, grabbed the microphone, and boom, hit my tooth. And now it felt like, oh my God. And I just opened. I was like, oh my God, I wonder how big. Did the whole tooth come out?
Is it gone?
You know how they lock it? And I was like, oh, what's it? But it was just a little bit, but nobody noticed. But when you're on stage and you're taking your tongue and going, holy crap.
Yeah.
I lost a whole tooth.
Yeah. It's like, I got to keep going.
Anything going on? Yeah, so, but it's just a funny story. But it's, we love that fear.
Mm.
You have to have it. If you're not nervous going on stage, then you're not doing it. Carol Burnett said this in her audio book. She's really, really great. And this is when she was first starting out, and she had this whole show in
the Carol Burnett
New
show.
York. Not the Carol Burnett show. This is pre-Carol Burnett. And it was a hit on Broadway, and it was a stand-up, basically, is what she was doing. And then she felt so confident about it, and she went on the stage, and she did the same performance as she always done with standing ovations, and this audience didn't get it, and she goes, I can't relax. I lost them. You lose something without that little bit of nerves.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my gosh, that's so true. You know, do something to make yourself a little bit, even if it's just changing something in a song or what you want to talk about during that performance.
Yes.
And you know you're leading up to it. It's just enough energy to keep that spark going. You know.
I'm a big proponent of shifting things just a little bit. I make myself crazy doing it sometimes because my wife knows. And anybody who has shared the stage with me knows that I get borderline debilitating stage fright. Before any time I go onto stage. Yeah, it's my heart is racing a million miles an hour. I can't make this stuff up. It's ridiculous. I get the crazy sweats. And then I go on the stage and I, know.
And then it's so different. And then you're so high afterwards, you know.
Yeah.
Adrenaline is like, it just feels great.
Yeah.
But I'm aware of that stage, you know, fright too. It doesn't sound as severe as you. Because I can't stop the lyrics going through. I said, I already know them, you know?
Yeah.
I lay in bed, stop, I already know it. But it just keeps getting into your head.
Yeah.
But then you're like, you're singing, you're like, oh, okay, is it coming? Is there? And I'm like, Lord, please give me that next lyric. Cause I think, oh, and it's there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, but it is fun.
Yeah.
But it's fun. You got to use that energy.
Yeah.
Nothing's negative energy.
Absolutely.
It's always positive energy, and you should be nervous going out. Okay?
And that, I think that's a good wrapping
point. And you
need
to bring a towel with you.
I think that's where we are. Seriously, I
you,
cannot
you wipe
go
your brow
towel.
And get on the stage.
The few times I've gone to a stage and realized I didn't have a towel there, I was like, no. It's happened once or twice. I can't
I
get through.
I have towels on each end in the wings. I have towels everywhere. Because as soon as I have a moment to go back.
I can be standing there. Yeah. Just like park and bark.
But when that
drenched.
Sweat gets in your eyes and you're like, oh my gosh, now I'm trying to.
Yeah. Sweat gets in your eyes.
I was singing this song. A lady came up to me after the show. I was singing I Am, I Said, I think, by Neil Diamond. But the sweat was really, she goes, you were really emotional. I saw you crying. And I said, thank you so much. And I turned around and I was like, that was sweat in my eyes. But good, you felt that way. Anyway.
Do you have a primary website?
I do. It's my own name.
DonnLamkin.com.
Yeah.
Cool. I will include that link as well.
All right.
Well, thank you so much for being here with me, man. Let's do some music.
All right.
All right. All right.
Get your gummy, get your get it, since you let it down on your daddy's knee. And ain't it a fine place to be?
Goggin' noggin, papa's rockin', like a mockingbird in a windy tree.
Oh yeah.
Well, that ain't no place for me.
Been there one time. Been there two times, been there three times more than I care to be. Oh, we're gonna make it through, get you to me. Life is good, life is fine, life is warm, life is kind, can you feel it? Love is great, love is right, keeps you warm late at night when you need it. Baby boy, daddy's joy, life's a toy, but you don't want to break it. Take it, Sullivan.
Like a sweet symphony, all you need is the key you can play.
There you go.
Hey!
I'll get you, Goomy, get you, get it. Since you laid it down, well, I have my say. Now don't be running away.
Goggin' noggin, papa's talking. Don't go walking off like you mean to play. Well, you can have it your way.
Been there one time, been there two times, been there three times more than I care to say. But we gonna make it through, get you goomy. Our life is good, life is fine, life is warm, life is kind, can you feel it? Yes, love is great, love is right, keeps you warm late at night when you need it.
Baby boy, that is joy, life's a toy, but you don't wanna break it. Like a sweet symphony, all you need is the key,
you can play it. Here we go, one time. Been there one time, been there two times, been there three times more than I care to say. Seen it one time, seen it two times, seen it three times, Lord, and it's plain to see. How are we gonna make it through, get you goomy? Da 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 and the fade out. Da da bum da da get you to me.
Hey, thanks so much for hanging out with us today. If you want to hear more stories like these, remember to hit that subscribe and notification bell to stay in the loop and updated on new episodes. And make sure to check out more from the amazing Donn Lamkin at donlamkin.com. D-O-N-N-L-A-M-K-I-N.com.